Now, after going through that description in its a graphical form, let us try to mathematically analyze that thing. Let us again revisit that x of t is equals to sine 2 pi f 0 t. Now, this signal is sampled at t is equals to nts. Now, its equivalent form, we are going to get it as x of t is equals to x of nts sine 2 pi f 0. This f 0 is calculated at t is equals to nts. Now, we know the trigonometric relation that sine theta is nothing but sine theta plus 2 pi m, provided that m should be an integer. If this relation is followed, then this particular identity holds true. Okay, if I use this particular identity here and I revisit this equation again, I can write it as this x of n now becomes sine 2 pi f 0 nts plus 2 pi m, provided again I am telling you that m should be an integer here. Let us rearrange this equation. X of n now can be written as sine, let me take out this 2 pi common, what remains inside is f 0 plus m, at the same time I will be taking out nts also common. So 2 pi is taken common, at the same time this nts is also taken common, what remains inside is f 0 plus m upon nts. As this nts term was not present here, it has now come into its denominator there. So if I rearrange this equation here, I'll be coming towards sine 2 pi f 0 plus m by n into 1 by ts, can be very well written as fs into nts. Now this m is an integer, this n is an integer, let me represent this ratio of two integers as k. Ratio of two integers is a rational number. Let me say that k is a rational number which can hold the value either positive or negative. So k can be either positive or negative. If I can write in this form, if I hold that relation, then I can write the equation as, now my x of n becomes, my earlier x of t becomes x of n, which is sampled at t is equal to nts, and it is giving me the form sine 2 pi f 0 plus k, which is nothing but the ratio of two integers m and n. N was an integer, nth sample, we had already discussed this particular concept, m by n, which is now represented by k. K can either hold a positive value or a negative value. So f0 plus or minus kfs into nts. Now see the thing here, the signal which was earlier represented by a frequency f0 hertz is now equivalently represented by a frequency, by a signal which holds a frequency of f0 plus or minus kfs. So that's what we have earlier discussed, the same equation, the same continuous time signal is now represented, when it has come into its digital form, it has been represented by the other frequency there. So this particular f0 is now called an aliased signal of this f0 plus kfs, or vice versa. So this is the concept of aliasing, wherein one frequency signal, when sampled, it takes the form of the other frequency signal, and that particular concept is nothing but aliasing. So that's what we have discussed, that's what we have discussed this particular concept earlier also in terms of its graphical form. Now, to avoid this aliasing, to distinguish clearly that original signal holds which frequency, the original signal holds f0 frequency or it holds f0 plus kfs frequency, that ambiguity is removed only when we follow a particular criteria, theorem, and that particular criteria is known as Nyquist criteria, and the theorem that describes that Nyquist criteria is nothing but the sampling theorem. We are about to discuss that Nyquist criteria or that sampling theorem henceforth. Okay, so to discuss that concept here again, let me concentrate upon the relation that holds true for the frequency there, right? Now, see, we know that my angular frequency of the analog signal, again let me remind, the angular frequency of analog signal is represented by omega. this omega, the angular frequency of digital signal is represented by this omega. Now, it is already we people have shared, Smita madam has shared with you the beautiful videos, those are related to Fourier transform, and in that particular video you might have come across the thing like this analog frequency, it lies in the range minus pi to pi, right? So this is very well true and very universal, universally proved thing that this angular frequency, it has a range from minus pi to 2 pi. At the same time we know that this omega is nothing but 2 pi f. Okay, so if I hold this relation true there, if this relation is held true in this case, I can write this equation as minus pi is less than or equal to 2 pi f is less than or equal to 2 pi. What I did is I have just replaced this omega by this 2 pi f. Now, again mere rearrangements play an important role here. Minus pi upon 2 pi is less than or equal to f is less than pi upon 2 pi. So this and this it gets cancelled, this and this is gets cancelled, and f lies in the range from minus 1 by 2 to 1 by 2. So what does it signify? It signifies that the highest frequency present in my analog signal, it lies in the range from minus 1 by 2 to 1 by 2, right? Now, what I'll do is, I'll try to sample this particular frequency. I'll try to sample this analog signal with sampling frequency fs. So here it comes to be minus 1 by 2 is less than or equal to f by fs is less than or equal to 1 by 2. Okay, so here let me say that the signal is sampled by a sampling frequency fs. Now this can be very well written as let me rearrange that equation, minus fs by 2 is less than or equal to f is less than, or I just wanted to make your life easy. Okay, let it be minus fs by 2 is less than or equal to f is less than fs by 2. So when I sample the particular analog signal with sampling frequency fs, that maximum frequency of that analog signal lies in the range from minus fs by 2 to fs by 2, right? So the maximum frequency that I am going to get in the sampled version, the maximum frequency that I am going to get in the sampled version, that lies in the range from minus fs by 2 to fs by 2, right? So this fs by 2 is nothing but, it is known as folding frequency. So this maximum frequency can take any value from this two range, from this entire range, minus fs by 2 to fs by 2. So we'll not be able to distinguish between those samples, those lie between that minus fs by 2 to fs by 2, because all those signals, my original analog frequency can take any value from that entire range. Now what to do in that case? To avoid that particular thing, my sampling frequency should be at least twice greater than the maximum frequency that is present in the signal. So my maximum frequency cannot takes only this particular value. So if my sampling frequency is twice greater than this sampling frequency, then my sampling frequency should be twice greater than this maximum frequency. I'm very sorry, this sampling frequency, if it is greater than twice of, at least twice greater than the maximum frequency, then there is a less chance of aliasing. And this particular criteria which gives us this relation is known as Nyquist criteria. Bas.